Hello, everybody. Thanks again to Dave and Center for bringing me here and allowing me to talk with you. I'm happy to be here. It's been great so far. I've had great food and good conversation. Nice to be on a campus that actually has greenery around it. I'm in New York City, so we have Central Park, but you know, we don't have a lake. So this is real nice to be here. And thanks to all the folks who did all the work, like Patrick and the folks working with him to make this possible. So, this whole love child thing, liberation studies and activism. I used to talk about liberation psychology, being that I'm a psychologist, both a community psychologist and a clinical psychologist. But, you know, psychology is really limiting in thinking about issues of liberation and social justice. So more and more, last year or two, I've been thinking much more about studies. So one thing nice here, we have an interdisciplinary group. We have folks from sociology, which is, in some ways, psychology. Community psychology is a bit of a blend of sociology and psychology. So this gives me a chance to talk to an interdisciplinary audience and to bring in some issues around, especially around practice today. So my last talk yesterday was much more around theory, and this one's going to be considerably more about practice, but I have to reiterate a little bit of theory to provide some context. So when you take some of the ideas in psychology and some of the ideas in activism, you get ways of promoting sociopolitical development, but also deal with a more holistic approach to human development. So that's going to be part of what I talk about today. So let me see. I think I have to press this here. So things I'm going to focus on a bit: fostering sociopolitical development in psychosocial interventions. That maybe shade a little bit into group therapy, but not into really traditional group therapy. But take a holistic human development approach. Rehabilitating and transforming some of the dominant discourse. As I said, psychology is very confining. But on the other hand, since we're dealing with human beings who have like real human issues that they deal with, to ignore the human development while you pursue a macro social agenda is a recipe for problems. And all the organizations, the seven organizations we have, two in Ireland, one in Northern Ireland, one in the Republic, one in South Africa, and four in the US, from the West Coast to the South in New Orleans, all of them sort of struggle with this issue of how to address youth and adult development issues, normative ones, usually, but sometimes people have more serious problems, while also giving them the tools to be agents of social change collectively in their city and in the state. So these two are always part, I think, of a whole, but generally the way we split our work, we think about macro level social forces, and we think about what's going on in families and individuals and small groups. So part of this is an effort to think in interventions that begin to bring those. And I have, I think, at least one example, I think, of Goodman and her associates at Boston College, where she really does bring those, I think, together very well and better than other efforts I've seen. And a little bit, I guess, about advancing progressive professional practice and unpacking that a little bit. I put this in dark here, the last item, because I'll probably say for the discussion, I'm really not going to get into that with these slides. So, what is just practice? Just as in justice? To answer that question, there's a few things, imperatives that really come with a justice approach, right? So, it has to do with not this kind of organization that's like this, the provider of services, the therapist, the group leader having control over what goes on, but something that's more closer, or at least aspires to be more like this. And when we think about authority and how it's exerted in the world, often someone is at the top of the pyramid and they run the show for the rest. And when you look at most classrooms, often, everybody's facing the only person who knows anything in the room, right? The professor or the teacher. And if you go into all universities, they even actually have all the seats nailed down, so you can't change the arrangement. It's a static arrangement where everybody faces the person at the top. So we don't want to replicate that. If our aims are really issues of empowerment, then we need to figure out a way to level power and authority a bit more and make it a little bit more horizontal and less vertical, which means we're going to undermine some of the fixed social roles that providers typically have. Probably the most important thing in this is working with groups and not individuals. I won't talk at all about one-on-one sort of modalities of psychological interventions or psychosocial interventions. They're always in groups. And those of you who do political work, you know it's always a collective effort. Isn't that right? Everybody brings their gifts to the table and works collectively towards some goal. And the idea that one person knows everything that needs to be learned and everybody else is a piggy bank where you deposit knowledge from the person who knows all is exactly the kind of model we're trying to undermine. So you have to have that mirrored in your approach. So it's always going to be a group approach. It's also going to be a bit expanded beyond political, though. Empowerment, well-being, social capital are all part of this. And by social capital, I'm talking about not just seeing yourself as an individual struggling against injustice and the circumstances of daily life. You are part of a network of people with shared experiences who come together collectively to address common issues. So all of these have to be a part of whatever kinds of interventions that we develop from a liberation perspective. This is just some of the kinds of ideas that I think are important to consider, some of the perspectives in thinking about this. I mentioned liberation studies, everything from cultural studies, feminist studies, critical race theory, queer studies, Marxist. All of those bring perspectives on and lenses through which we can understand and do a social analysis of the world. So all of those become very relevant. You notice I didn't put clinical psychology out there, right? Because I think the thing that really differentiates this from a lecture I might give to my colleagues is that the biggest problem, I think, with clinical psychology and some of the health professions is, but especially clinical and medicine, is this notion of abnormal function. Which, if you know anything about the DSM diagnostic manual statistical of the disorders that are used to diagnose us all, those change from addition to addition. It suggests they're in existence one, then poof, they're gone. What would happen to them? Can you imagine the idea if you wake up one morning and poof, malaria is gone? That would be nice, but there's something odd about having disorders come and go seemingly at random. And so what happens is I'm really removing the whole notion of psychopathology and abnormal functioning from this approach to doing interventions. So you won't hear me talking about anything having to do with diagnosis of individuals. We will be doing some analysis and assessment of social systems, though, and judging them to be ill in the sense of have unjust institutions, but we won't be talking about the micro level abnormalities and atypical functions of individuals. So all these things are important. This echoes what I said before on group therapy. Restorative justice is now being used. That's a major issue going on in our sites in Ireland. An approach to dealing with prolonged conflict between groups. So it takes more of a large group macro perspective. Social identity, which is the basis of a lot of conflict here and around the world, and ethnic conflicts. Cultural education, which is getting people grounded in understanding their own educational history, and especially in anti-colonial work. It's important to understand your heritage and your history, lest that be lost in the process of acculturation. And sometimes that actually involves a reclamation if the colonizer or even in the experience, for example, of slavery, much of that history has been erased as a matter of policy. So all these things are playing kind of a role when we're talking about that. Trauma is one of the really important things and stress that we can use to think about what's going on. And increasingly I'm seeing, and I was talking about this with students over this last couple days, that community organizers are being much more interested in thinking about trauma and issues of wellness, both among themselves and with those that they work with. Because in working with young people, when we have like 8 or 9 sessions, often a young person, you know, I had all my little plans about what I was gonna deal with in the sessions, some of the kind of stuff I'll talk about later, and they'll talk about someone they saw got shot. Or there'd be a buzz in the school about someone who got shot. So young people are constantly being traumatized by things going on in the environment. That has a direct impact on their ability to do work in around macro issues. So how can we find some sort of balance? And Goodman, who I mentioned I'll talk about later, she really says that that's a false dichotomy around the person in small groups and families and macro systems, because the two are interdependent. So I'm just trying to bring something along in that scale, not erase or minimize work with systems change, because that's critical and that's kind of where I'm based in my own thinking, but to begin to expand that a bit, especially when you're working with young people. One organizer, though, at our California site, she said she had been a member of a group of senior organizers who regularly got together to combat their own issues around burnout. And it's a poorly kept secret that many organizations that are really dedicated to social change don't always apply those principles of treating people in just ways in their own organizations, ironically enough. And so they suffer from sort of all kinds of crazy stuff, abuse of power, lack of democratic process, stereotypes about groups. In fact, in many of my studies, it's been interesting that when people describe their own social political development, some of their most powerful and useful experiences in their own social analysis is when they've seen others who are in a group that they're a member of treat their own badly. So a person, for example, who's gay or lesbian coming to, let's say, a black student union, finding there's no analysis, no political sophistication around issues of sexual orientation. And that kind of jarring experience, well, I thought I was part of the group, but I'm seeing now I'm being marginalized. I thought I was coming here so I wouldn't be marginalized. Those kind of negative experiences, as they describe them, are among their most powerful. So there's a whole range of things that really require us to have a sophistication around group dynamics and individual function to do our best work as organizers. If we want these organizations to be sustainable over time. I've highlighted just therapy, not because it's the most relevant to what we're talking about, but because I think it has done a very good job of integrating all political concerns and psychological concerns into one area. So I'm going to highlight that one a bit as I go along. I have a couple copies. I didn't make a lot of them. But just to give you an example, I'm going to mention a couple of these here. So these are 2 pages. So just spread them around. Look at them. But I'll just tell you a little bit about what just therapy, how it's described. Just therapy is a reflective approach to therapy developed by workers of the Family Center, which, by the way, is in New Zealand, not in the U.S. A fundamental feature of just therapy is an attention paid to the broader cultural, gender, social, spiritual, economic, and psychological context underlying the problems experienced by those whom therapists work. It expresses the philosophy and commitment to cultural, gender, and socioeconomic equity. It follows the philosophy of the Family Center's commitment to the eradication of racism, sexism, and poverty. So every time they mention therapy, often they talk about therapy and community work. It's grown into an international movement among those who are really tired of sort of having to choose between working and thinking about and conceptualizing the micro level and the macro level. And there are a variety of other work like that. For example, there's a family therapist. And it's not a coincidence that this is family, because families are systems. And if you work with systems, like if I were to see a family in treatment, and they come in with the identified problem being the kid who's skipping school, you often find that that's, you really can't understand or have an impact on the situation if you just focus on the so-called identified problem. Because in societies, in these systems, there's always one part that someone says, this is the problem. But when you begin to look, you see that there's interaction. There's a system there. And in fact, if you change that individual, it disrupts the relationships and changes the functioning of the system. So this begins to reveal certain kinds of theories that, work across levels of analysis better than others. One of those being any theory in the psychological world that gives some credence to systems functioning, number one, acknowledges the power and the influence of authority, number two, and it gives an official, explicit position for the role of the environment in human functioning. So when we think about trauma, for example, there's always a traumatic agent from outside of the individual that contributes to the psychological phenomena of trauma. There's always an outside agent. In stress, there also is some sort of outside agent. So when we think about oppression, right, we don't think about oppression being inside the head. We think of there always being some external agent. So all the psychological theories, many of which say everything that's wrong with you is going on inside your head, do not officially, at the root of the theory, acknowledge the environment as having a role in the problem at all. So it's a very selective approach we take in the thinking about the theories that we bring into thinking about interventions related to both the individual, but also in strengthening those and engaging those who are having problems individually into social change work. So I'm going to talk a little bit about two different theoretical perspectives I use in the political work that inform my thinking about interventions. And this is one I call much more of a heuristic theory, that, and I put stage in quotes because based on my empirical work with surveys anyway, I don't have a whole lot of faith in stage models, because people start and jump in places. Like if you have a family who's very involved in political work, and the best single predictor of a person's political behavior as an adult is the parental involvement in politics. So you always have this connection. So if you have a very political family, you may skip two or three of these and land at a starting point of four. But it's a good heuristic if you're working with people, because it helps you to understand the potential spectrum that people have. So I find this actually quite useful in working with groups, but much less useful in research. The first stage is really being relatively unaware of social injustice. So that's kind of not really something you spend a whole lot of time thinking about. And I think if you're in a position of relative privilege in a society, you have the luxury of not worrying about that so much. But you don't have to have had the personal experience of oppression, because there are a lot of folks who get involved through other means. But in any case, there are folks who are kind of, a lot of their thinking is focused elsewhere, and they're not really thinking about that. Far larger is a group of folks who know it, but they aren't necessarily concerned about it. And when I talk to young people, and a lot of the rap videos we would show and discuss with them, are really about people getting theirs, what the young people call getting paid. You gotta do what you gotta do. And really, we're saying, yeah, we know about all that stuff, but look, you know what? I gotta get paid, so I'll do what I have to do. Some take a social, what we would call an antisocial approach to that, meaning get involved in an underground economy that causes harm to others. But also there's one that isn't that, one the folks who take advantage and open, you know, slide through that sort of narrow crack in the window of opportunity, move in institutions that folks like them typically aren't in, but don't rock the boat at all. So they get through, they get theirs, and they get out, but they have not really expanded the options for folks who may follow them in those institutions will have to fight the same battles they fought. So we don't really see any social change out of that. We do, we see one individual getting through. Both of those are really adapting to an unjust, unfair system. Then moving on to critical and pre-critical and critical, where folks begin to encounter some experiences that begin to change their thinking. And I'll give some quotes for that to show you what I mean by that. And so this knowledge begins then to form what was one of my focuses is on today, and in my work generally, is beginning to give a critical social analysis that begins to understand a causal relationship between what they see in their everyday life and causal factors that contribute to it. The analogy I used yesterday is, for those of you, how many of you here have actually gone in late to a movie, let's say 15 minutes late to the movie, you look on the screen and can't figure out what the hell is going on? Well, that's because you're really, right, you're seeing a snapshot and you don't have, to use the analogy, the history, the context, the setup of the characters to explain that snapshot. And in my thinking, in my work, I really see critical social analysis that has a historical basis is essentially providing that moving picture view of these sort of mundane circumstances that face you at this given moment. You know, you've been someplace and someone like goes off on seeming some meaningful thing and all of a sudden says, what's wrong with them? What was the big deal? They were like flipping out over that, right? But maybe if you know the person a little bit better and know what they've experienced in that institution, you realize that there's a whole lot that led up to this outburst. And the really thing I think that distinguishes those of us who are interested in social and institutional change and traditional clinical work is when we see that outburst, we don't view it critically in this vacuum of this person going crazy at some seemingly innocuous remark. We ask ourselves, what led up to this? And are there institutional factors and other factors that contributed to that? Whereas a clinical psychologist would probably sort of see, well, they need to cope better with the challenges they're facing in the workplace. And notice there's no social analysis in that description. What's happened in the last few years, we're talking about now what are called microaggressions. Those little things that people say, it's sort of like, you know, the drop, drop, drop on your head, you know. Any one of them in isolation is not an issue, but if you go through an experience in an institution where people always are surprised if you're smart, they always are surprised if you're articulate or you know how to do something. And you kind of get these little subtle things, oh, you know how to do that? Over and over and over again, at some point, you're not going to take them as likely as you did before. Two very different ways of thinking about it, but I think we can use information from both sides of that analysis to inform political work. Last deliberation stage is when you take strategic action consistent with some critical social analysis to act on the problem at its source, the root of the problem. So when I think about working, I want to first understand a little bit about the kinds of analyses that are associated with action, but also sort of seeing ways in which we can strengthen the connection between having a useful social analysis and actually taking action. Because remember, things like psychology, the point is to understand human behavior. Engaging in political work is a behavior. And presumably we have some of the tools to understand the antecedents of behavior. So I try to take those tools from conventional psychology and think about how they can be applied to understand increasing the likelihood that folks will be involved in social justice work. Second theory that I've been using more in research still echoes this idea, what's the connection between having a critical social analysis and acting, and having a critical social analysis and not acting. And those of you in my previous lecture, you'll hear me repeat sort of the sort of ways I talk about that. It's sort of a Starbucks analysis, where you're essentially an armchair analyst who has a very articulate, sophisticated political understanding of cause and effect and social forces, but don't actually get engaged in any work to change those things you've uncovered through your analysis. So I'm thinking there's two things. One, you have to have an opportunity and an environment to do so, typically in the form of an organization, a collective. And you also have a sense of agency, believing that, well, if I act on my analysis, there's some likelihood there will be a beneficial outcome. And then the variety of things that we've talked about that we contribute, we think, to both of those. And so starting off, we're really going to focus really on that box in the upper left and thinking about this. So let's get beyond sort of the theorizing at the academic level and go to something we did when we brought all the two members from all six of our sites to the seventh site in Cape Town, South Africa. The problem is having this far-flung study. Folks don't get to see each other face-to-face, and you know, it takes so many Google Hangouts and Skype sessions, you want to actually be able to see people, you know, shake their hand. So we brought them there, and we had the young people. We asked them what they thought about political development. Now remember, these are young people who are already in organizations we consider exemplary in doing community organizing or things related to social justice in some ways. So they're not coming to this with no ideas. But when you ask them this question, ask them just to write it on the board, I just cut out so you can see their handwriting as well. These are sort of the things they associated with it. Some things that surprised us, talking about mental preparation for identifying barriers that they'll face. Okay? Which accepts some analysis, but also some sort of strategy for handling what they're going to be dealing with. Okay? Something that presumably interventions could incorporate. But they ask, sort of answer the question, why is the world so unequal? Has anybody here figured that out, by the way? Why is the world so unequal? I'm sure at least somebody's written a book that has tried to get at some element of that question. But they're asking the same question. This word history comes back again. Again, temporal relationship, cause and effect, context for what we see today. History of the global economy and inequality. So these are folks aged from about earliest, youngest one 16, oldest one probably about 20. But then other things, combat limited aspirations. So they're really talking about political development giving you something that you can fight with and fight against things that will be a problem for you. They mentioned powers, we all would. So a lot of the ideas are really here. History comes back again. And actually, this, I think it fits nicely with a slide I'll show in a few minutes. This is another one that had more of an artistic piece. And in thinking about practice, I found, and most of you, I think, who work with young people discovered this already, that in the arts, the performing arts, the visual arts, all the arts are critically important in developing politically as well as socially as a form of expression. So they took time to really talk about a variety of things, and to them they kind of mixed together, as you look at this, things that have to do with politics and things that have to do with their own personal development. So this division that we make, which again Goodman says is a falsehood, really isn't held by the young people. They see their organizations and what they're doing this for, and even talk about political development. They freely mix in a variety of other things they think are important to them. And this is the way, when we think about doing interventions, to always try to figure out ways to keep you in connection with the people you're working with. Always in connection, always contributing, always trying to find ways to bridge gaps between people and to develop shared ideas. And again, the groups, when you look at Freire's work, when you look at most of the folks who talk about this, we talk about dialogue, and all this, again, as we found, very critical to the work. So back to that upper left-hand corner, as I did before, I talk about this because when we're talking about social analysis, this to me is the best definition I found, learning to think critically about accepted ways of thinking and feeling, discerning the hidden interests and underlying assumptions and framing notions, and the various ways in which they get played out. And I really like this idea of mundane particulars, because I think one thing that distinguishes those who have a social analysis is not just something they talk about political meanings, but they see this in all around them all the time, and they can apply it readily to new situations. And again, this keeps coming up over and over, and is critically important in understanding and having a social analysis understands cause and effect and the role of context. So thinking as a psychologist, the issue is an understanding of this really is a cognitive skill that we can use our understanding from areas of education and cognitive psychology to really promote the development of this analysis that's needed for action, as well as thinking about ways we can translate that into behavior. And when we're talking about injustice, we usually talk about some sort of inequality, as in distributive justice. And so this becomes an important issue in this definition. And as I asked before, there's extra credit today if anybody can tell me who said this. How about somebody who was there and remembers?
Gramsci.
Yeah, Gramsci, that's right. Okay, so I say teachers take heart because here's a quote that illustrates the power of your role here as teachers. As part of the class, we examine the systematic and historical factors related to poverty, as well as how dynamics of race, gender, and class shape the face of destitution in America. We learn how aspects of our past and daily lives were related to these issues, making the class a profoundly personal experience. Now, I haven't actually had a student tell me my class was profound. I don't know if you all have. But still, this really tells us, I think, how teaching and the educational process can have a huge effect on socio-political development. And I think one of the things that are in synergy with these intellectual insights are that in a university you can choose your courses and you can choose from a multitude of opportunities to get involved in politics on your campus. So you can develop your own synergy around energy interests that you have, and consistently among multiple samples I've looked at who've had at least a year or two of college, these kinds of experiences in college really have had a huge effect and have real implications for how we think about experiential learning in developing critical social analysis. So folks, you know the whole notion of field trips, remember those from back in the day, right? Or opportunities to be involved in learning in a particular setting. All of these things are important, and we're trying to learn about how the organizations that work with young people in community organizing sort of are intentional about the kind of settings and opportunities they create for young people. Okay. One connection I want to make with education. Now, and I was able to convince the Chicago Public School System to actually pay me to develop critical social analysis in their students. Imagine that. And the way I marketed that, if you will, is to make a connection between critical thinking and critical social analysis. And in fact, the two, and this is a quote from the website below, I think the two share a good bit. And if the tech gods cooperate here, I'll pull up just to give you a sense of what they're talking about. And this is really not a political site. Oh, yes, it did. Okay. They have a wheel here of all the things that are considered part of critical thinking. And a lot of them are, and they touch on issues of social justice in some ways there, and also in terms of developing campaigns, developing questions, targets, and purposes. They talk in one of these about issues of fairness. So there's a, there's, it brings in some of these issue, ethical issue and political issues here. And so there's a really nice synergy around that. So for those of you who are doing school interventions, connecting with teachers, and most schools profess to want to build critical thinking. All my education friends tell me you can't directly teach critical thinking. It's an indirect sort of outcome. But call it what you will, there's an opportunity really to do in schools. This is a way of either an enrichment activity around critical thinking or actually integrating in history and other social studies classes and so forth. So I also, I would often try to find allies in schools, teachers, who wanted to do this work in their classrooms. And it'd be an interesting study, which I have not done, but an interesting study to sort of determine if this generalizes to critical thinking about the subject matter in their schools. We encourage them to think critically about, let's see if I can get this to, hold on a minute, I gotta get it to flip back.
It was probably the PC screen only button, right?
Well, we'll try that.
The one at the top?
Oh, let's go too fast.
The one at the top?
PC screen only.
See, I'm trying to... No, I don't. Let me see if I can try another approach to this. Any guess about these here? See, I have to rely on the group intelligence here to...
keep going over, maybe. Isn't there something that says slideshow?
There may be one if I... button there before that.
We can see them anyway, even if they're not the full screen.
Does anybody know?
Did you try the duplicate option that you had in that menu?
The second. I think that was what he just did.
No, he did the third one. No?
Well, if you just double-click on the one you want, we can still see it.
Yeah, it's going to be... Yeah, you can see that one. See if I can...
What about the magnifying glass down the bottom? Does that make it bigger?
No, I don't think I'm going to start over. Okay. All right. I'm going to resist this one. Just showing this to talk about this political civic engagement issue. It's kind of what a couple of students have talked about the question of whether civic engagement activity leads to political engagement activity or not, and also, is there a distinction between the two? I mean, I think as scholars, we can talk about how the two are distinct, but one question we had is that young people see the two as different. And this is a content analysis we did of a survey we were working with and used. And what did I say? I meant to say factor analysis. I don't know what I said. Factor analysis of the two. And we got fairly good separation on these two that we gave these labels that show some distinction between them, but a lot of overlap in skills, I think. And some actually did have some political content. But if you're so interested in sort of, based at least on this study, of about 250 high school age young people, when we looked at that, these are how the items kind of fell out. So some distinctions, but I think it's best viewed more as a continuum than really a set of categories. But it lets you sort of think about, if in the work you're doing, the activities you have evolved to you, what kind of opportunities that you might have young people engage in that could lead to some of the outcomes that you're seeking. But these are the two ways, certainly in much of literature we talk about our work in either civic terms or political terms. And I've seen in most organizations I work with, they do at least some civic activities. Like I just visited our site in Chicago a few weeks ago, and they had a large back to school picnic where they provided food for people. They've gotten a lot of donated school supplies. They handed out lots of school supplies. Things you might do in a purely civic sort of intervention. And they saw that as a critical part of what they're doing, first of one, recruiting new members to develop an ongoing relationship with people, to keep their ear to the ground about what's going on, to meet the real needs that the people in the community had. So in the world of practice, there is some blurring. But I think that the difference is that this becomes sort of added on to work in political organizations, whereas in civic organizations that might well do this kind of back to school program they had, which was not explicitly political, by the way. There were no political speeches of any sort. But it was part of a larger strategy for them, whereas in civic work, this important activity would be done for the value it creates on its own thing, which is bringing people in the community together, developing relationships, and giving people things like school supplies that are essential for them to be successful. So, to break this up a little bit, I'm going to now give you a chance to experience what the young people, we did with the young people, what we call critical consciousness coaching, with the video, So, we had a series of questions we asked them. And our approach to coaching was to not really tell them anything, in the sense that you should think about it this way, you should think about it that way. I think one of the things that built my commitment to being much more concerned about the process of developing critical social analysis, rather than the outcomes, whether they end up blue or red or liberal or conservative, is that I could never agree with anything with my graduate students. We would fight endlessly over the ideology that was going to save us all. And we could not ever agree on that. But we all had really good arguments, but we still didn't agree. We drew different conclusions from information. We made a good argument, all those critical thinking skills, all that. So we decided, you know, what we can agree on is a quality process to reach your decisions, even though you may come out in different places. And this really kind of came out of a commitment more to the process than the outcome. So we developed a series of questions that we'd ask. First, what did you see? Which is a description of what you saw in the video. What did it mean? How did you interpret what you saw? Why did you come to that conclusion? Meaning, what can you show, present as evidence that that conclusion makes sense from what you saw? And then dealing with the emotional and sentiment part of it. So like when you, how does that square with your values? How does that square with your thinking? Think that, that what was going on there was a good thing to do or a bad thing to do? So they're trying to square with their own values and feelings. And last and most difficult and least frequently found in our content analysis of these sessions is, okay, you say you don't like it, what would you do about it? How might you think about a change in the things that you think aren't going on, but that are going on that you think are bad, bad for your community? So the video I'm going to show you now, next, is a direct opposite of the one that modeled critical social analysis that I showed yesterday. So what I want you all to do is think about those things. So can you remember those four words and caps? The first one, what did you
see?
What did it
mean? Why'd you think that?
Why'd you think that?
How'd it make you feel?
Right, and sort of what might you do? But part of it is we would show videos, some videos that we thought were despicable and hated as adults, but we wouldn't say that. And let them sort of talk about using these four things as sort of scaffolding for the discussion. Now, we didn't just start this the first section and went merrily along. What I'm not telling you about is the ways we had to create a setting where people were willing to take intellectual risks with the material. I'll come back to that later because that was hugely important because it took a couple of sessions just to really create the environment where they would really begin to talk about this. So I will play that now, and so pull this up. I had this problem yesterday. I don't know why I'm having more today. Okay, so you want to watch these things because there's a lot of things in this video that speak without speaking, but there's also some dialogue that I think you could do a critique of as well.
Would it help to turn off the lights?
Yeah, why don't you do that?
Would somebody be willing to do that right near the door?
This is explicit version, so if your ears are tender, you might want to step out.
All I care about is money in the city that I'm from. I'ma sip until I feel it, I'ma smoke until it's done. I don't really give a fuck, and my excuse is that I'm young. And I'm only getting older, somebody should have told you I'm on one. Yeah, fuck it, I'm on one. white cups and I got that drink. Could be purple or could be pink, depending on how you mix that shit. Money to be got, never get that shit, cause I'm on. I support it.
I'm running purple flowers, it's burning my chest. I bury the most cash and burning the rest. Walking on the clouds, suspended in the net. The ones beneath me recognize the red bottoms I wear. Burning in the belt, moving kids to the heels. Big shorty on the sink, do it for the thrill. Kiss you on your neck and tell you everything is great. Even though I'm out on bond and might be facing it, still running with the same niggas to the death of me. Ever seen a million cash, gotta count it carefully. Ever made love to the woman of your dreams? Woo! In a room full of money out in London and she screams? Oh, baby, I can take it there. Call Mark Jacobs personally to make a pair. So yeah, we own when the feeling ain't fair. And it's double M-G until I get the chair.
All I care about is money in the city that I'm from. I'ma sip until I feel it, I'ma smoke until it's done. I don't really give a fuck and my excuses that I'm young. And I'm only getting older, somebody should have told you. I'm on one, yeah, fuck it, I'm on one. Yeah, I said I'm on one.
So you get the idea.
White cups and I got that drink. Could be purple or could be pink, depending on how you mix that shit. Money to be got, never get that shit, cause I'm on. I support it. I walk around the club. Fuck everybody.
Okay, so what we do, we play something like this and just ask the question, so what'd you see going on here? So I'm going to ask you that question. What'd you see going on here? Meanwhile, I'll see so I can get this screen ready. Handle it a little bit. Go ahead. Come on, y'all. I'm expecting you all to say something now. Now, don't be like my classes.
Cars, beautiful women, nice apartment in a really awesome city.
Right. And so we got this good description, and that's what we would seek. Like, that was always the easier of the things to for folks to say. And you saw the order of those. We predicted that there'd be a decreasing frequency of responses in the higher categories than the lower ones. So that's what we looked for, did when we did the analysis. So let's move up to the next one. What was, what do you think it meant? What did you get out of it?
I mean, it seemed like the, what is the lyric? I'm young and I'm only, I don't care because I'm young. What is the
My excuse is that I'm
My excuse is that I'm young and I'm just getting older. It's the
right.
Sort of screw everything, I don't care. I've sort of resigned myself.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a sense of sort of but it's not really a sense of resignation. I think that means. I
mm-hmm.
think it's more of a I'm just not even gonna think about it. Like
I mean, there's not much of a depth of analysis there, is there?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what struck me. It's like, can you say a little bit more about that? I mean, it's like, it's not, it's just kind of you're doing it.
Yeah, but.
For me, like a sort of sleepwalking kind of thing almost. Enjoying it all, but it was not really thinking it through.
I didn't get the sense of him enjoying it. I thought there was no self. I was getting a feeling that it was fairly cynical and it wasn't a celebration of it.
Mm-hmm.
It was sort of, that it was a negative commentary. That's what I was picking up.
Mm-hmm.
And the imagery at the beginning, yeah, it was a nice building and there was a good view, but it looked like everybody was bored out of their minds.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
so maybe like jaded kind of bored?
Yeah, they were just,
yeah.
Most, everybody was passive and not doing anything.
Well, they hadn't all got their turn. These were all kind of leading. Luminaries, this was like number one for a long time.
Was it? I don't
So each one goes around and does their little version of this.
Okay. But nonetheless, the lyrics of the guy who was singing it first, I could understand him better than the other guy, but I took it to be pretty negative commentary, that he wasn't celebrating it, he was suggesting that this is pretty nihilistic and pointless.
Mm-hmm.
That was what I took, but maybe I was reading into it.
Yeah, I mean, the party lyrics, they were like the least exotic images of Miami. Like, when you think of Miami, you're like South Beach and parties, and instead it's like there's no real color, the images are very, except for the one guy wearing red, and he's the one that's sort of celebrating, but there is a sense of like, yeah, like, this is what I do, like, yeah, I'm on one, that's what we do, like, I got cops on my back, I got people on my back, grown-ups on my back, like, I'm just going to do this. I don't need to.
Mm-hmm. There was one lyric I picked out in particular where he was saying he was facing 8 years, so like maybe it doesn't even matter what he does in the future, but
because he'll be going what?
Because he could be going to jail, you know. So survive right now in this moment. But it seems like they're getting old and they're kind of getting tired of being in the moment, but they're still doing it anyway because that's what they know I do.
So, to switch a little bit to more of the gut check reaction, what's your gut reaction to it? Because we have that as well as a head, right? I mean, just like it, find it offensive.
Depressing.
Depressing. Okay. What are you saying?
It's a bleak outlook, and if you bleak. Identify with any of these individuals, it's not, motivational or
mm-hmm.
I mean, another interpretation could be sleek, modern, clean. I mean, everything was very sleek, modern, and clean, you know, like a white interior of a white car and crisp makeup and like crisp t-shirts. So, you know, very modern line. So it could also be a lifestyle of that sort of promote, like presenting a lifestyle that is not cluttered with life and mess and gross. So,
yeah.
Where the worst thing you do in the video is drive on the wrong side of the street.
I was just confused by it, because what I saw was a bunch of guys who didn't really care if they've already made it and it's cool, but the lyric that I was hearing was that the things they care about are their city, one. I didn't really see them doing anything about that. And then making money, and I didn't quite get the connection there either. So I was confused.
I just felt like the characters or the people were interchangeable. So you talked a little about the sleek and modern kind of white personality. So you have a white background and a black background, and you could have really used anyone. And as they rotated through the lyrics, they changed, and they were kind of in the same position, but it could have been anyone at any time. It's mm-hmm. this story that keeps going on, and people just come in and out of that situation. Temporary, I guess, versus permanent.
Uh-huh.
I was probably preoccupied with the guy in the white suit in the car because he kept popping up. And what I was getting from it was, this is a success symbol under the circumstances, that's a whole lot like what is considered American success. You know, it's having material success, fine clothes, beautiful women, and here he was. But it seemed like it was saying, this is, why don't we grab the same success that we see all around us? We can't get it the same way, but let's get it this way. And yet a fatalism about it, like, I don't know how long this is gonna last, but this is what I'm gonna do. But so that was what was striking me, was that part of it. Whether that's what the rapper was saying is his scheme, or he just was reacting to it, I wasn't really quite sure on that.
Right. Well, I start showing this because in my experience, I'm not showing this particular one because this is a relatively new one. To young people, but I know kind of how they would respond to this. And they respond closer to what you said about the material, because really it's the imagery more that's in some ways hard-hitting. There's a lot of sort of signifying in it, signifying about certain kinds of cars. Now, notice the women. What was going on with the women? And no one mentioned that, so I want to put that up.
What I noticed, they were, these, I'm not from this culture, so a lot of lyrics were, I couldn't capture them, but the image for me was more significant. I saw a lot of stereotypes. I saw black guys, certain age group, certain physical features, certain gesture, certain tools, and women in a certain role, in a certain position. It was a gender power behind it. It was symbolic. They were like an object, like anything else. They were not interacting with them. They were doing just certain kind of behavior they were expecting. Smiling, touching their ears, their ears, that kind of stuff.
When I would ask somebody, if they gave me a response, I'd ask them else, well, what were the women doing in the video? Exactly what were they doing?
One was lying on the back of the car.
Right.
One was in the car, in the passenger seat, in the front seat, apparently having a good time.
Well, not related to what they were doing, but just that they chose a white woman versus a woman of the same race as the guy who was driving the car. So that just, I don't know what message that portrays, especially to young people, but I'm assuming, especially for African-American young girls, that success also is in the form of whiteness. Mm-hmm. Or beauty is in the form of whiteness. Or desire.
And what strikes me is it's because I've seen so many of these things. Is this example of women show like furniture?
Yeah.
Okay. They're not saying anything. They're kind of just, they're propped.
Yeah.
They're like props. And so I typically would not say that, but I would keep repeating the question, but what were the women actually doing? I mean, see, you all are kind of smart and you all kind of get into intellectually. But I say, well, what were they doing? And so they would describe and saying, so why would she be sitting on the top of a car like that?
Right.
How come she wasn't one of the rappers there? So asking questions, because you see this kind of again and again, and they begin to see this pattern, sort of focusing of women sort of essentially being objects, decoration, backdrop, props, and not saying anything. It's not that there's no, they don't say anything.
Do you think that you'll show this video compared to the one you showed yesterday?
Because yeah, you all, like, you're being subject to this, because these things like really get on my nerves. But we had one which was completely, well, why don't you just say a little bit about your impressions of the first one?
Well, it was stimulated by previous comments, but now I'm seeing this kind of polar opposites. It's a lot about success, but then the people seem really miserable, and as a viewer, I just kind of wanted it to be done with. Whereas the video yesterday was much more, lively and entertaining, and there were hardships, which seemed less, they weren't not present. They were like beneath the material successes. But I think the portrayal of the characters' dispositions was opposite.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was pretty continuous.
And the message, you say the message was different? In terms of what was trying to be communicated through the video?
Yeah, I mean, the one yesterday was, I don't know, the starting of kind of that critical analysis. And this one is just, I don't feel like there's any sort of potential for that in these characters.
Right. See, in sort of way I would ask her, and I'm leading her a little bit, I'm saying, ask her about, what it was about, and sort of pushing. And that's what we do. We really would lead a little bit to try to draw things out, but ask lots and lots and lots and lots of questions, very rarely make statements. But use those four areas to sort of get it come out, because the visuals and many of these things, what's really interesting is that, like, in the video I showed yesterday, which probably won't have time to show today. But the rapper was going through sort of a slice of life, a day in his life of going off, and they kind of did this pickpocket thing of this guy in the street. Then they, and it was a lot about them needing trying to find some money. And then he was trying to talk some hamburgers out of this server at a fast food place. Then it shifts, and he's like, puts on a tux, and he is a server at this really high-end thing with the mayors, all the major developers of real estate for the city are, and they're talking about each other of how they're gonna tear down all the public housing and build new housing, high-end housing. And so he uses that, he does a political commentary over this whole other world that he's not a part of, and he brings this analysis to it. And the one woman who appears has all her clothes on and is also spinning like a DJ in the film, as opposed to kind of having nothing but kind of decoration. They don't use the N-word, and sort of she's not portrayed as an object. So very different things. So what we would do, we would play both of these. There, in this one, it's really not at all about what he says, really. But it's just this dreary sort of feeling you were saying. And I think it's sort of jaded. I got all this stuff. In one way, I want to show it, but another reason, there's a jaded quality to the whole thing. But the young people, when they see it, they say, oh, boom, they got all the things I want. Your interpretation is interesting. You'll get a variety of interpretations. You focus on having a white woman in the video. The young men would tend to say, when you get it, when you're successful, you can have any color woman you want. You want a white one, you can have that. You want a black one, you have that. You can, the world is your oyster. And there's this portrayal of that. So they really will key in on a video like this on the trappings of success. Even though I think in some ways they were saying, it ain't all that great.
Right.
But usually, for example, working with young people, they would not get to that. Because in part, it's a class thing here. If you've experienced, a degree of material success, you realize, yeah, it's great, but, it doesn't necessarily equally be happy. But for a lot of the young folks who see this, they say, I just want to get it. I'll let you know if it's not making me happy. But for now, I just want to get it. So there's a real piece around this, and also around masculinity. There's a lot of masculinity message around that. So we would use videos like this, one, to talk about, well, what is success? What constitutes success? Around the issue of the role of women. And also the use of both drugs, alcohol and drugs, and how much you use at any one time. But we would do this by using questions, lots of questions. So the beauty of hip-hop is that you can find a video that almost depicts any issue that you want to talk about. But rather than you as an adult having to talk about it, you let someone who they feel a connection with talk to about it. And so that's how we use it as a strategy. But as I say, even as you begin, over time what we found is young men tend to think more critically about these things and these images and sort of start talking more about the values that in some ways they see them as promoting. And we begin to talk about, especially videos that talk about what's going on in the street, like the other one did a little bit more. And ultimately they begin to show this evidence of an analysis between sort of these videos of what's going on and how this behavior in the community, what translates to in their future and issues like that. But what I'm jumping to now is thinking about, even when you sort of achieve a degree of social analysis, you still have to move to action, and you still have to deal with relationships. Because the young men, early on, they were not used to taking any intellectual risks. So in the classroom, like, apparently, no one ever asked them anything. So I would ask questions in the beginning, and I would get, like, monosyllabic experience. Like the first one I'd show, they'd say, I said, well, what'd you think of that? It's all right. I liked it. It was pretty good. And then we try to pull something out, and someone would say something, well, you know, he was shooting up a lot of people. And then Noah would say, oh man, that's stupid, why are you saying that shit? So obviously that's not encouraging people, what, to say more. So we had to get them to develop a set of norms for respect, which I found if there's any, if I had to choose one word in the English language that I would say is key to doing this kind of work, is creating an atmosphere where people respect each other. Just like Aretha Franklin said, right, R-E-S-P-E-C-T. That is really central, because the issue of disrespect being, and then when you think about male honor culture, the notion of being respected by other men and not being disrespected in an honor culture is very important. And these young men, the issue of disrespect is a huge one. It tends to shut things down or either start fights. So you have to create an atmosphere where people can take risk without worrying about being disrespected and deal with all the consequences of that. So that's an important part of that. But once you get past that, at some point, okay, now that we have some understanding of what's going on, and we understand both the personal aspects of my own, myself personally, and society, how do you take action? What do you do to change the things that you find to be problematic? So I imagine most of you have heard and done participatory action research or aware of it, right? So this is something I adapted from that and I use in working with young men. I was working with a group in Brooklyn around this, and I was trying to think about a way to rework sort of the cycle that we talk about in PAR in a way that would work for them. So I'm going to take you through this just as an example of ways that I found that have been useful in trying to think about the basics of campaigns. So I'd be interested in whether you do when we get the questions and answers, and I'm going to make sure we have some time for that. So actually, it's what, 5:18 now? I'm going to not show this. Time got away from me and stop, so we can have some time for questions. Let me stop. Suddenly, stop. But let me stop. We did have at least some discussions around the video, but let's move off now and just stop. And if you want to see this before I leave, I will show it, but give me a chance to ask some questions.
Have you ever shown the film Beyond Beats and Rhymes?
I have not shown it. That came out after I was doing the work directly. But it does represent a whole area of work going on. I mentioned this before about there's a professor at the Center for Studies. Studies, he's actually the director of it in Chicago. And he does this whole thing about the business of rap music. He focuses on the whole way it's marketed, and essentially, when you watch it, you realize it shows like essentially the people who are buying the songs being chumps. But he doesn't say that. But when he goes through and shows the marketing and how they think about the market and sort of think about the people on the other end, young people had no idea that they were sort of being worked over by the sort of sophisticated approach to the marketing or the economic side of it. But that one puts the sort of icing on the cake because it shows how they only really market certain kinds of rap and don't market other kinds, which they also are not really aware of. So this genre of what's called gangster rap is really blown up much larger. It was really sort of a sliver until NWA and some other groups found great success, and then that whole this whole gangster rap genre blew up that we're seeing now. So yes, that's a powerful picture for young people. It talks again about the business of this industry. Although, you know, more white kids buy, you know, rap than black kids do. So there's a whole voyeuristic element of this.
And that's captured too, in that film too.
Yeah, the voyeuristic aspect of it. So, but the whole thing is about kind of who's in your neighborhood, who contradicts stereotypes. If you have people contradict stereotypes, you're less vulnerable to internalizing them if you don't.
Could you share a little bit about the distinction that you pointed between civic engagement and political engagement? Could you just elaborate on, was it, because you talked more about the spectrum or how youth really see it as different, why is it that academics see it the same, or because I also see it as different, so I'm just wondering, is there a reason why one would be different and not different?
Well, I mean, I see like humanitarian actions, alleviating suffering of others, is don't necessarily have any impact on the root causes of that suffering. Creating institutions like, you know, softball leagues, football, settlement housework and all that does help people who are struggling. It helps them to get on their feet and move on. And those are essential to any society, and people need to have the sort of discretionary time to be able to be volunteers in that. But I guess we make a distinction in the scholarly way is that those don't actually have any impact on what's generating the people who are homeless, the folks who are struggling at the bottom, people who are hungry. It doesn't have any effect on the causes. It just alleviates suffering. And that you need, at some point, you know, like a public health psychiatrist in Chicago, I'm blocking his name now, he always said, he was a physician, he says, you know, when I see two or three people, kids come in with lead poisoning, it's a medical problem. I see the 100th kid come in, it's a social problem. And so you've got to balance dealing with that, with suffering, but then also the causes of suffering. So that's kind of the distinction I make between the two. But in the real world of running organization and building connections with the organization, you have to kind of fold the two together. And young people don't necessarily, at least early on, give much credence to that distinction. And so it's not something, in the political education process, you don't necessarily try to make that distinction more. You just want to help them understand things from a systemic analysis. Mm-hmm.
And picking up on that, I had a reaction to your graph that you showed both today and yesterday, in which you had an opportunity structure in a box that had a dotted line around it. There was an arrow going one way.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe I misinterpreted what opportunity structure meant, but what occurred to me was why there wasn't a feedback to expand the opportunity structure. In other words, why isn't the kind of political engagement, the analysis, and then the political engagement that follows from that oriented toward how do we alter our opportunity structure? How do we change the relations of power? How do we change the systemic barriers that we're confronting such that our opportunities, both in the immediate short term, but also to expand opportunities in the future, are enhanced?
You mean opportunities for people to get involved in political work? Is that what you mean, or?
Well, again, I guess I'm asking what that means. What is the
okay.
opportunity?
Well, it's sort of a mix of analysis. when I talk about the relationship between social analysis and activism, the question is, what does the individual need to be active? They need to have some organization or group in which they can engage collectively around a shared problem. So the opportunity structure is sort of at a different level of analysis than the where I'm asking that question about how the individual moved from the analysis to work. I'm moving to the analysis of an organization or a group, which provides you. So if you kind of have an analysis, you want to really get involved in political work, but you say, well, how do I get involved in it? I can't go up there and change this thing I'm worried about. Where can I get, you know, learn and work with others? Well, you're an organization, then you become part of an organization, then suddenly you're working with a collective, and then when we do a survey and ask you, have you done any of these political actions, you will say yes. So that provides what you need to move from analysis to action.
Right, but so what I'm suggesting building off of that is that one consequence of engaging in political activity is that you create more opportunities for real change to occur. In other words, that...
That's right. Well, so when that you say opportunities, you mean... The organization is providing opportunities. When you say more, you mean within an organization or new
no,
organization?
No, in general. So that what people are confronting, in my own opinion, is that there's an imbalance of power. Mm-hmm. And that the most effective kind of political engagement people can engage in is to identify those imbalances of power and then discern what would be the appropriate kinds of actions that would begin to alter that imbalance of power. And in doing that, you create incentives and opportunities, because there are greater opportunities for people to participate. Right now, they face very much of a sort of a vicious circle of lack of power, which is a huge disincentive, of course, because people become fatalistic, etc. So as those opportunities, as that imbalance becomes more of a balance that favors people who are currently disempowered, they're in a position then to have more opportunities to engage in political activity.
Well, I think what happens is, one example would be, let's say that, well, and the data shows that that youth of color are much less involved in civic and political activities. So they join an organization, and one of the things they decide they want to do, we want to have more opportunities for young people that live in these communities to engage in that. So they develop, they say that the problem is that the policies, city policy around providing opportunities for young people needs to be changed so that there are more opportunities. So then they try to engage, they get into, try to get an audience with the person who's involved in, I don't know, children and youth development or the mayor to see if they can get more opportunities available for young people who have fewer. So in that sense, their policy action creates new opportunities. I'm not sure if it's that what you're talking about.
I mean, gay straight alliances actually are an example of what Patrick's saying, right? I mean, you actually have, everybody's in school, so there's an organization, right. So it fits your opportunity. But it may be that some kids feel they don't fit. So they can take within that organization, they can actually change the organization to expand what are the opportunities for people like them and people that they...
So they can, like, for example, start an organization.
Well, they can expand the very sort of institution that they're part of to say, we need a space and we need to belong and that sort of thing. So they're changing the organization and the opportunities for people who come in.
And different organizations offer better possibilities than others. I mean, some organizations, precisely because they're more service-oriented, don't really give the same opportunity to empower for young people to gain skills and a sense of agency and a sense of empowerment, whereas other organizations, because they have that analysis.
I understand what you're saying. So when I talk about, I'm only talking about organizations that are, when I say the opportunity structure, I'm talking about opportunity structure in the form of organizations that are committed to social justice work. So a young person gets involved in there. So they can develop any kind of campaign they want to, whether it's creating more opportunities within that organization, which is more of an internal organizational change strategy, or develop a strategy for improved opportunities around the community.
The more macro question is really what I was...
Right, so that's really, but that's often a policy issue. You have to, unless you're gonna try to start your own organizations, there may be a resource issue that you need around creating new organizations. Or you can even create new chapters. One option, a lot of them, what they do is they have, one of these organizations has young people at several different schools, so they seed other schools to create and mobilize more people to do a variety of things around the campaigns that they run. But I think, I certainly see what you mean. We need more opportunities for young people doing a wider variety of opportunities. Right now, the issue of youth community organizing is a really small sliver of the opportunities that young people have to get engaged.
Can you talk a little bit about the ethics of this kind of work with respect to you're creating a space for youth to change, to develop critical analysis, and then to take action based on that. All of those things can have consequences which aren't always good for the individual, and these are young people. So what is the ethic that guides this kind of work? What issues arise and how are those addressed, you know, from that standpoint?
That's really an important question. First thing I should say is for the 8 to 9 sessions that this particular intervention was, we would only do it when it was embedded in a larger organization that was working with you. So for example, they may have an ongoing like young men's development group. We would plug in for 8 weeks. What our conditions were that you had to give them some opportunities to use their analysis to actually do something. Because if you develop analysis about social forces affecting them, they have no opportunity to engage in those and have some positive experiences, you're doing more harm than good. That's a big ethical issue. The other thing is one of my students got some funds to help young people deal with inequalities in Fulton County schools in Atlanta. And what we made sure we do, we talked to all the parents individually to tell them what their young people were doing to engage them in relationship to ensure they know what was going and they were okay with that. Because it can be stressful, it can be difficult. Now, nothing they were doing was dangerous, and they weren't doing anything that was going to get them arrested, for example. But you want to definitely have the parents or whoever the guardian is to know what's going on, and better yet, to get involved. To over long term, you know, one of the most successful efforts in changing the curriculum in California schools was done by parents and young people working together in the same organization. Some role differentiation, but it was definitely partnership. Kavitha Medrania, who's at the Black Philanthropies, wrote a book about their experiences in the California. So that's a critical thing. The other thing, though, I think comes back to...
One follow-up question, yeah. Real quick. You've been suggesting ways to develop sort of generic critical skills, but the examples you're giving seem like they're focused on, okay, we want this policy in this school. How do you get them from the video where they've got some generic skills to see what's happening and what isn't, to setting a goal and acting on it?
Well, they set the goals. Like, to give an example with the student I was mentioning, they did a series of things around this, and they brought in, Anderson's brought in some examples to sort of make it concrete for them. Then they asked him, well, what kind of things are you all interested in doing? And they said, some of them from northern Fulton County and some from southern. They said, well, we're really upset because, like, their schools, they have salad bars. We don't have salad bars in our school. We wonder why we don't. We're in the same county. And so they saw inequalities in the two schools. They wanted to understand better why they weren't getting them. So that really, so the issue then came for them. But I didn't talk about sort of defining oppression and all that, but they saw some social inequality. They wanted to better understand it, see how what the students thought about it, and see if they could change it. So from there then, the graduate students worked with them over time to research the problem first, which is last slide was about, and then to actually, and the first Fulton County IRBs wouldn't let them go and interview students at the schools. But then they got a newspaper article, and then they suddenly say, well, we didn't mean they couldn't go in. We just wanted to make sure it wouldn't interrupt instructional processes. So they did went in, and they did this whole piece around that. So that's kind of how the flow goes. But obviously it requires, you know, at times for adults to run some interference around that, especially if it's a first experience. Young people doing this, you want to have a success experience. And that's where sort of more traditional youth development outcomes, people having a sense of self-confidence, feeling empowered. And in another instance where the young women, I had a colleague running a parallel work with young women, and they targeted the condition of the girls' bathrooms in the schools. And so we went, though, first and talked to the principal and says, look, the young women have come to some conclusions about that they were unhappy with the condition of the schools. Would you be willing, if they did a video and did the research on it, and would you hear them out? Not saying you have to do it, but would you at least hear them out and respectful, so blowing them off, right? Because we want to make sure that they at least kind of got through step one with this thing. And he agreed to hear them. So they did a video and they showed the peeling pain and all that kind of stuff. And he went, I guess it popped higher up on his to-do list, but he went to the district and got some money and got them repainted and did some work on them. So that was a huge experience for them to do that in their school. You work on that every day and you see it wouldn't be there if it wasn't for you. So you need to scaffold the early ones, but later it's actually instructive when you don't, when you do get blown off. You know, but you've got a little bit of a base to work with.
Did you have a question before
break? I'm really interested in this analysis to action part, and I'm wondering if, did you see anything in this process of developing their analysis? Does it change sort of, when thinking about campaigns, the bar that the young people will sort of set for themselves before the campaign, like, does it change what they think is possible in terms of a win based on how their critical analysis tools have been shaped?
That's a good question. I don't think not the bar, the analysis is doesn't, it's more the outcomes when they try something. It has an influence over it. It's like, well, if we can do this, we can do something bigger. I think that's more, and I think though the analysis gives them a much better understanding of this idea of finding a target, defining a problem, finding a target, developing a strategy, taking an action, assessing the action, that sort of whole. So they get that, and it's but I think when they have successes, then they start it, the bar develops. It's really, and all these diagrams are really simplistic because it's much more of a transactional thing, that when you have successes, you expand, your analysis expands and changes in response to what happened with initiative. Then you begin to look at other causes that you think are important, and you choose different targets, and the targets get more challenging, and there's institutional sustainability, and all kinds of things come into play. But so I don't think we can really single out analysis. In that, I think successes have more. But that's tricky too, because it's important to see successes even when other people see failures. If you see, like, you know, someone, like, would you say that this, the protests that you did here in Madison around the governor's policy on these matters, do you think that was a success or failure? Or something else? Those protests, were they successful? Or, and you don't have to use my words, use whatever words, how would you describe them in terms of their usefulness and worthwhileness?
I think they were useful in raising awareness and bringing attention to stuff that was getting rammed through the legislature. Clearly wasn't successful in stopping that, but I think it really highlighted a number of things that, and connected the story to a number of other similar issues going on nationwide. So I think it depends on how you define success, but it didn't stop at 10 from moving ahead.
And I think that's an important point. Sort of when I think about psychologists, all the cognitive behavioral therapists, it's how you interpret and make sense out of your experience is important to your mood. You get depressed or not. So organizers I know experience would say what you say, well, you know, we mobilized more people. That was the largest gathering we've ever had around political issues in this city in 50 years. We built some coalitions with groups that weren't even talking to us 5 years ago. And so they see mobilizing, engaging, building consciousness and awareness as always an outcome. So if they don't actually, the initiative didn't go their way, they reframe it so that they won't come out of it demoralized. That's a real critical skill to work with, and I think in young people as well.
So we're pretty much out of time. So maybe, yeah, you can hang around and ask Rod questions if you still have others, but let's give him a group thanks.
Thank you.